take your crack, you put it in this top piece right here, and you burn it. And most people's pleasure is seeing the clouds, and after that's gone, that's your high. There's no more.
Keith Haring was an American artist born on May 4, 1954 in Reading, PA. Although Keith's time on Earth was limited to just 31 years, his legacy is one that continues to grow, inspire, and empower others. During the 1980s, he reached the height of his career during a time where art, graffiti, and drugs were all booming.
The dealers, it's an industry. This is an industry right here. This is going, it's going on right here.
We ain't got no money.
Look at this. I mean, look at it. Look, just look at it. Yeah, of course I'm angry. I mean, I'm married. I have friends that I sometimes can't invite down here because it's a real problem. I mean, there's one right there. You know, I mean, they're all over the place.
Can't get back up on my feet. I was up on my feet once, down again. I used to be 32, 34. I'm not even at that. Look at me, I went 95 pounds. My clothes hanging off of me. I ain't been home in 4 days. I ain't got no sleep in 4 days. I've been eating. We're at 95 pounds.
In the summer of 1986, Keith Haring loaded up a van with materials and a ladder and headed to an abandoned handball court located on East 127th Street, 2nd Avenue, and Harlem River Drive in New York City. And he managed to finish painting the mural in just one day. You may think, how cool is it to be able to do a public art in a place seen by so many people? How could he have gotten permission? Truth is, he didn't have any permission. Keith said, when you have a van, ladders, and paint, policemen don't even consider asking you whether you have any permission. They just assume you do, said Haring. Upon wrapping up the night, he and his friends were smoking and taking pictures to document the wall, and a cop showed up and arrested Haring for painting illegally.
And this is permissible. I mean, you're not breaking any
law. Is this illegal or not?
Yeah, it is. It is illegal. It depends on the policeman that catches you. I have been handcuffed and arrested. Sometimes I'm just given $10 fines.
Sometimes told to move along, buddy. Yeah.
Or sometimes when they catch me, they're eager to meet me because they've been wondering who was doing it this long.
Haring's fame worked to his favor. He was able to get out of trouble with just a $100 fine after the mural was completed, it was vandalized and made into a pro-crack mural, and quickly painted over gray. To Keith's favor, the Parks Department asked him to come back and paint the mural again. Although the mural is a little different than the original version, it still has the same message. Crack is whack. Does the mural Crack is Whack do a good job at communicating this message?
It takes you out of the world, you know, like when you feel confused and you feel alone and you feel a lot of pressure and everything. It's like you go and you take a hit.
So why is this mural so good at communicating its message? Like I said earlier, Harlem in the 1980s was overcome by drugs, especially crack. The mural's graffiti style, clear lines, recognizable shapes, and verbatim make it very easy to understand no matter what age or prior art knowledge. So many people had been affected by the drug that the mural became an image for news and media to use whenever discussing the crack epidemic. It was even used for some commercials.
Listen to your friends and to tell you to try it. And most of all, y'all, don't you buy it. Your friends are wrong and to tell you to use it. So listen to the message that's in our music. Find some help if it's you who did it. Crack is real wax, so you better get with it. Don't do it. Don't do it.
Life is fresh. You better believe it. A crack is whack. No, you don't need it. Life is fresh. Yes, you better believe it. A crack is whack. No, you don't need it.
It reminds me of kids playing on the playground, those old paintings that you'd see like in your school, holding hands.
And what do you think it's about?
I think it is people standing up to crack, running away from what holds them down. and they're just excited that they're not there anymore.
And do you like this work?
I think it has good meaning, yeah.
And do you think that public art money should be used to fund works of art like this?
Yeah, because anything can be an inspiration, anything can change someone's day. So I definitely think if I were in a bad place and seeing this, this could be a wake-up call just by seeing it in the street.
Cool. So the artist that did this, this actually went up illegally. He did it on an abandoned handball court, all illegally, and then the city decided to preserve it. So do you think it was a good idea for the city to preserve it?
I do.
Why?
Because it actually shows that they're listening and they care and that they don't want this in the streets anymore. Maybe this can help other people too.
Okay. And do you think that public money should be used to fund works of art like this?
No.
No? How come?
Because I think people are going to do it whether there's a drawing like this or not, it's not going to stop anybody.
Okay. Now, when this work of art was made, it was actually vandalism. He did it on an abandoned handball court. Do you think it was right for the city to preserve it after the fact that it was done?
No.
How come?
Because if it was vandalism, it's a crime.
Have you seen this artwork before?
Yes, I have.
And what do you think it's about?
Crack is whack.
Yeah, do you drugs. Like this work of art? Do you think it's successful?
Yeah.
What makes it a successful work of art?
It's getting a message across.
Okay. Should works like this be funded by the government within that budget?
Yeah, as long as it's a public service announcement, such as this, like, crack is whack, and it's using language that people get, and, you know... So the statement, the message is very clear.
Right. Now, this went up illegally when he did it at first, and then the city decided to preserve it. Do you think that was the right choice for the city to do? It was in an abandoned handball court in Harlem, where, like, crack was at its highest during the time. This was in 86.
Probably it looks better than what was there, so preserving it, yes.
What are your first impressions about this artwork?
It's very bright. The red and black is really vibrant. It catches my attention.
Well, is it successful as a public artwork?
I would say so. It looks like whoever painted this looks like they're trying to portray some sort of message here about drugs and stuff. So I would say, yeah, definitely.
How do you feel about vandalism becoming art?
I think if it looks really awesome and the general public is okay with it, then I don't see why not. I mean, it's a beautiful piece of art, so I think it should be leave it as is.
Do you think that the message it's trying to communicate is successful?
Yeah, it's pretty forward. It says crack is whack, and it's got a skeleton hand and money out. I mean, it shows it's pretty clear on the message he's trying to send here. So
crack is whack fits into the history of public art because it is accessible by so many people, and it also serves a purpose in the community because of its site specificity. Keith designed this mural with his studio assistant Benny in mind, who was battling a crack addiction. Although the journey for Benny wasn't easy, they were able to find him help and overcome this disease. This work of art, like many of Keith Haring's works, are a reminder of his political activism and role in educating others. Although his works of art may seem like playful figures and simple lines, they usually have a deeper meaning.